It is my pleasure to introduce David Burcham, who is president of Loyola Marymount University. As many of you know, on May 31st, it will be his last day after serving as president for 5 years. He will be leaving the position. The board of trustees, the students, the faculty, the staff, we all asked him to reconsider, but to no avail. I think his wife must have prevailed on him. But he has been a tremendous friend to me and to the Center for the Study of Los Angeles. More importantly, he's been a tremendous leader. Leadership inspires, leadership motivates action, leadership transforms. David, you have transformed LMU for the better, and we thank you, all of us here, and we're going to miss you. David Burcham, president of the Loyola Marymount University.
Good morning and welcome to the second annual Forecast LA event. The Levy Center for the Study of Los Angeles and Beacon Economics sponsor this event, and it is a little bit of a nuanced approach to your traditional economic forecast. In addition to the hardcore economics, which we'll hear about this morning, the Levy Center conducts, using a lot of our students, conducts a very detailed opinion survey of LA residents, including Los Angeles County mayors, asking them basic questions, all of the respondents, about the quality of life that they are enjoying or not enjoying in Los Angeles, where they see the city and the area leading and going. And that gets combined, Fernando's work gets combined then with the hardcore economics and produces a very nuanced look at our future. I want to thank all the folks that are with us, particularly I thank the sponsors of this event and the donors that have contributed generously not only to this event, but to the Levy Center, which does such great work under Fernando Guerra's tutelage for the whole year. Today, I'm very pleased to welcome, and you'll hear from them a little later on this morning, some of my colleagues that are leading community college districts in the area, from Los Angeles Community College District, Santa Monica College, and my hometown of Long Beach Community College. As you know, community colleges, in addition to being in the national news under the president's initiatives, as well as in California under Governor Brown's initiatives, are looked at as a real force both in education, in terms of reducing costs at four-year institutions and providing marketable skills for those after a two-year program, for those that want to go directly into the workforce, but also their economic engines of some magnitude. And you'll learn a little bit more about that in a few minutes. Later, we look in our closing remarks to views of our state treasurer, John Chang, who I know, as you know, has a very impressive background and is knowledgeable, probably the most knowledgeable of our state's finances. The main event that I, or the main speaker that I get to introduce now is a great friend of LMU, a friend of mine, Supervisor Don Knabe, who attends many events at LMU. He's lectured, guest lectured to many of Fernando Guerra's classes. Our students, hundreds of our students, have benefited from his political acumen and his insight into what makes Los Angeles County work and what needs to be fixed. And it's a great honor for me to welcome Supervisor Knabe here today to offer us a few remarks. Don?
Good morning. Wow, it's like Sunday school. It is early. So anyway, good morning to all of you, and David, thank you for that very kind introduction. I just would say up front to all of you, it's a privilege to be here. I want a big thank you to Fernando for once again including me. He's been a dear friend for many, many years, and has a program that I think really touches the heart and soul of Los Angeles County. So congratulations to you and your students and to everyone here today. I also ask you to pardon me for dining and dashing, but as you know, in Los Angeles County, I have two new colleagues, and I gotta make sure I get back so they don't do something while I'm gone. But I too want to begin by just thanking President Burcham for your outstanding service here at LMU, and to not only just the LMU, but to the entire region. You've been a good friend, and your outreach goes way beyond the boundaries of this great university. And he's a neighbor to my son, and so we see him from time to time at other events in Long Beach. But congratulations, and to you and your wife and family, good retirement. I'm looking forward to that in 2016. No, that was a joke, okay? It's okay, you know, smile a little bit out there. I know it's early. As we all know, there's been a lot of discourse across the country about the high cost and accelerating cost of higher education. And I know how personally committed that all of you have been on this issue here at LMU, particularly the upcoming $100 million initiative you established for need-based scholarship. And as we all know, education should never be out of reach or based on where you live or how much money your parents have. And I probably shouldn't say this at LMU, but having sent two sons through Pepperdine, yeah, I got the boo. That's from the staff. Steve Napolitano from my office out there, LMU graduate and LMU law school graduate. After redistricting in 2012, I unfortunately lost LMU to the second district, and I really miss having it as part of my district. But the thing that I've always admired about LMU is, in addition to the great educational opportunities, is the fact that they teach education and life after education and learning very early. And the students here volunteer over 175,000 hours a year. That is huge. You know, in the county, we have hundreds of thousands of volunteers and millions of hours, and it saves the county in close to about $18 million a year in services that are performed by volunteers. And you don't get them along the way unless you nurture that in early age. So what you do here at LMU obviously benefits all five districts, and I really commend you on the commitment to the community and for really developing young people who understand that they are part of something that is much bigger than themselves. I know you're interested in the morning ahead of you, and a study like Forecast LA is truly a one of a kind and just so important to policy leaders. I represent a district of more than 2 million people, and that's a lot more than some governors. In total, we have 88 cities here in the county of Los Angeles, the largest county in America. The researchers spoke to 57 of the 88 city managers in our region, 57 of 88. The one thing that I did know, so this is, I think I had some help on this statistic, is that 95% of those leaders were men. So we need to work on that, okay? Wow, this is really, you guys are really soft and quiet. You want me to whisper? But throughout this study, we were able to slice and dice the data, which is critical to such a diverse county as ours, even in just one of the five districts. And my signature over there that says, what does it feel like to be an Angeleno? I said, it's diversity on steroids. And that's what Los Angeles County is. And I did hear some replies, I'm not an Angeleno. You gotta remember that. So they wouldn't sign that, Fernando. But anyway, I think that's a great idea, and it's really interesting to see some of the comments over there. But you know, even I, representing 2 million people, I can't think of my district as one. I have 27 of the 88 cities, and vast unincorporated areas in my district. The issues are so different from a Hermosa Beach to a Diamond Bar, to Hacienda Heights, to Long Beach, to La Mirada, having both the ports in my district, LAX, having the 57, 10, and 60 juncture out at the eastern part of the county in my district, and having, I'm one of the few elected officials in America that has an island. I have Catalina Island in my district as well, too. So we need to look at a variety of data and how it impacts everyone. Obviously, there's the quantitative piece, but we also need to hear where public opinion is. Not just the people who call our offices to complain, but the people that need our services and how they feel about those services and how they feel and how they understand. We need to understand how they work and play and get around. It shows their values and what is most important to them. And as a representative of those 2 million folks, that's very, very important to me personally and to my staff. Let me give you an example. Everybody across the county, the state, and the nation is talking about the minimum wage. Last week, one of my colleagues brought forth a motion for the Los Angeles Economic Development Corporation to review the studies to date, all the many studies to date, and see what impact it would have on the county of Los Angeles. And let me be clear, no one can raise a family in Los Angeles County on the minimum wage. But if you say the minimum wage has no impact on business, you have your head in the sand. If you say it's a disaster for business, you have your head in the sand. So it's important to me that you have all the stakeholders involved in the discussion and the debate. And that's why I made a motion to have our Small Business Commission host a series of forums across all of Los Angeles County in its 4,000 square miles for small businesses. As many of you in this room know, small businesses have created 2/3 of the new jobs in the county since the recession. And I really think that we need to know the impact on them, the positive piece, the negative piece, and how we might be able to work together to make this work. And I really think that there's often a misunderstanding about business. I'm not talking about the recent $70 million pay packages at Google right down the street. I'm talking about the restaurants, the mom and pop shops, the other small businesses that have very, very slim profit margins. We've seen the impact on those businesses in other jurisdictions, which have implemented an increase in the minimum wage. We must not repeat their missteps, but rather be informed and guided by their experiences and come up with a plan to help those in need. And I found some other really interesting things in your survey that you're going to hear about. Public transit. I know the world like we all do, and we all left really early to allow for traffic this morning. Sees Los Angeles as a car culture, and we still are. But there's really been a real shift in people accepting and embracing and believing that public transit can be a real option for this region. And part of that is being able to connect the dots throughout the county and have a transit system that works for everyone. We've seen it here in Los Angeles County, and we tell the federal government every time we go back there to ask for more money, they say, well, find a revenue source. Well, you know what, folks? The citizens of Los Angeles County have taxed themselves three times, and in addition to wanting to pay for more transportation needs. Heck, I just want some public transit to the airport, and that's what we're working on. Yes. One final thing that I really found interesting was how optimistic about the future the people are in Los Angeles County, about their own financial stability and job security. And that's pretty good news in light of how much the region suffered through the Great Recession. And we always hear how people are frustrated with the gridlock at the federal level, as we all are. A Gallup said last month that 18% of those surveyed, only 18% of those surveyed approve of the job Congress is doing, 18%. Yet the survey that we see today that you're going to be talking about gets you closer to home, to the city you live in, or even closer to your neighborhood, and most importantly, what people feel and feeling better about what is going on. People appear to feel safe and very optimistic. That is really great news for the future of this region because, as it is stated in a study, invested and empowered people are the greatest assets a community can have. And I say I'm into that, And I say thank you for inviting me this morning, and have a great day. And I know you're going to slice, dice, and find out just what's going on. And congratulations for the survey, the study, and thank you to all of you for inviting me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Supervisor Knabe, and for your comments and also for your years of public service. We greatly appreciate it. We do miss him representing LMU. I would now like to call up Chris Thornberg, founding partner of Beacon Economics and the economic sage of Los Angeles. Economic forecasting is a perilous profession, and Chris is one of the best. Chris?
Thank you, sir. Good morning. Oh, that was awful. I'm not going to let you do to me what you did to poor supervisor. Good morning. Oh, one more time. You can do better than that. Good morning. Ah, forget it. All right. Never mind. It's great to be here. You know, we have Beacon Economics, I should say, has done a forecast for Los Angeles for a number of years now. But this is our second year partnering with LMU and, of course, the Levy Center. And I couldn't be thrilled more. I'm going to echo the words of the supervisor when he said that the partnership we're dealing with here is absolutely perfect. I mean, after all, what you're talking about, and when you think about policymaking is more or less at the convergence of what I would call public opinion and economics. And too often, economics and public opinion can be a little bit orthogonal. Hence, we end up, of course, with a lot of weird policy decisions. And I think that what we're starting to do here is converge the two, bring the economic data together with sort of public opinions about these various sorts of economic issues. And hopefully, we can start to create a convergence that ultimately can help guide better policy. This morning, I'm going to be up here talking about the national economy, the state economy, what's going on out there, for better and for worse, as the case may be. After me, of course, Jordan Levine's going to come up and talk a little bit more specifically about LA County itself and give you the outlook for what our local economy is doing. So with that in mind, let me go ahead and bring you back to 2014, last year when we did this, because I always like to start out a little bit with, I'm going to come down here a little bit easier, I'm closer to the machine so I can click better. I always like to start out with a little bit of what I said last year, and this is some of the big points I had last year. I said, check, consumers definitely continue to spend over the course of last year. Housing recovery is going to rebound by the end of the year. Absolutely on that one as well. We started to see some good numbers there towards the end of the year. Commercial is going to continue its slow recovery. That worked pretty well as well. Exports, business spending keeping up, absolutely. California, one of the stronger economies in the nation. Well, you know, we recently got some new numbers for the state and some revised figures for last year. And by the way, that's a big double check because very good news for the state of California as well as LA. Inflation, not a chance. I got that one pretty right. We have, not only is inflation not an issue at this point in time, but we have yet to, we've actually seen it slow down quite a bit because, of course, the decline in energy prices we saw towards the end of last year. Now, of course, my last two things, a little bit less, positive on these. One of them, of course, was the energy sector is continuing to boom. Well, as you know, of course, last year we had a very big surprise with a collapse in oil prices, and that is having some impact on the oil production sector. But I'm not necessarily worried about that. No, by the way, energy sector is continuing to boom despite that. And last but not least, treasuries to stabilize, long-term rates to drift up slowly. Well, I got that one wrong. Now, mind you, what everybody was saying was interest rates were going to start going up towards the end of last year with the end of quantitative easing. Of course, quite the opposite. Rates actually dived. And right now, we're seeing 10-year treasuries again below the 2% range. And yes, the below 4% mortgage rate is with us again as well. So that's another big boost to the economy thinking towards this year. So I kind of got that right, but obviously still going in a different direction. Well, what about right now? Where are we? Now, you may have heard, you know, it's interesting. I was talking to one of the radio stations this morning, and he made the point that some folks are talking about a negative number in the first quarter this year in terms of growth rates. I don't think that's the case at all. But I do think the first quarter is going to be a little bit weak. We had some of the issues at the port. We had some issues with weather, and particularly in the eastern part. We have some issues with the global economy. But all said and done, everything I'm looking at right now is transitory. And if you look at the fundamentals, the underlying sources of strength in the California and the national economy, everything's really ticking up. We had so much momentum coming into the beginning of this year that whatever stumbling we may do in the first quarter will quickly be erased as we get into the last three quarters of the year. And all said and done, we're looking for about a 3% growth rate, perhaps even a little higher over the course of this year, whatever happens that first quarter. Now, where is all this optimism coming from? Well, first and foremost, if you look over the last 3 years, basically about 2.5% growth, a little less than 2.5% growth over all the three of these years. But the underlying structure of growth through that period of time has changed quite dramatically. Indeed, one of the most important sources of new growth was actually having to do with consumers. 2 years ago, consumers added about 1.2% to the economy. Last year, about 1.7%. This year, they're going to add close to 2%. Lots of good things happening there. Businesses starting to invest more and more, particularly in terms of structures, and that's going to carry us through. Residential investment, that's actually slowed down some for reasons we're going to discuss, but that's going to start bouncing back in this year as well. And really, government spending, which has been one of the big weak points, has at least started to stabilize. You add that all up, and we're coming into this year with a lot of very good news. The only big issue out there, of course, has to do with the external accounts, namely, of course, a very weak global economy. We're going to come back to that in just a second. Let's go ahead and start with consumers and, of course, consumer spending. But you have to remember that retail sales numbers are nominal. That is to say, they're not price-adjusted. And, of course, as already noted, one of the biggest issues we're seeing in the U.S. economy right now has to do with the dramatic fall in both oil prices as well as gasoline prices. Indeed, once you price-adjust, it turns out that coming into the first 2 months of this year, consumer spending is expanding at one of the fastest paces it has in the last decade. Indeed, or at this point in time, growing close to about a little over 3% a year-on-year basis. Not quite the last decade, but going back to 2006. As the case may be. Very solid numbers there. Now, why are consumers willing to spend more at this particular point in time? Well, a lot of it has to do, of course, with the fact that the labor market has really started to turn a corner. What you're seeing up there, of course, over the course of the last year is a little over 3.1 million jobs added to the economy, and that's even with this weak March number we had. You know, a lot of folks, again, looked at that March number and they go, oh, wow, that looks bad. You know, 1 month does not a trend make. And candidly, the February numbers seem suspiciously strong. So in many ways, I think it's just a return to the mean. Again, over the last year, well over 3 million jobs, an unemployment rate at a standard level, the standard unemployment rate well below 6% at this particular point in time. The only number out there that still remains, shall we say, relatively weak would be the U6. Now, the U6, of course, includes both discouraged workers, folks who would like to have a job but can't find one, as well as those who are part-time for economic reasons, means they prefer full-time work. You look at that number, it's still relatively elevated, up there around 11% or so, but still moving down at a more rapid pace than it was the last couple of years. The labor markets have really started to pick up some speed. Now, you look at those 3 million jobs, you say, wow, that's a really good number. And Pete, you probably have heard some of the rhetoric coming out of Washington, D.C., that this is the best number we've seen in terms of job growth since the late 1990s. But do keep in mind, what we're really starting to do is finally climbing out of the jobs hole that occurred over the course of the Great Recession. So all said and done, this is a great first step to truly getting out of that downturn and getting into what I call a real recovery mode. Of course, with all these new jobs, we're also seeing more income. Now, incomes are being boosted simply by the number of new jobs, along with, of course, some of the benefits of cheaper prices, particularly cheaper gasoline prices, and overall real aggregate incomes are growing at about 4%. That's a good number. It's the best number we've seen in a while. Now, the other part of what's happening out there has to do with the individual earners' wages. That is to say, on a worker-by-worker basis. Those numbers have yet to really rise. Indeed, if you look over the last couple of years, nominal wages have more or less been tracking inflation. Not very good news. But things do seem to be heating up there. And we know certainly in some certain submarkets, not the least of which, for example, is San Francisco, per-worker wages are definitely on their way up right now. What point in time will that sort of little pockets of strength in wages start to become a more aggregate phenomenon? When will it start becoming more economy-wide? Well, the answer is probably at some point in 2015. This is a number kind of going back over time where I'm looking at the U6 rate relative to increases in weekly incomes. And as you can see, at least going the last couple labor cycles, when the U6 rate gets down into about the 10% range, that's when you see overall income start to rise. Well, right now, the U6 is running at about a little over 11%, and that would suggest probably about July or August of this year, worker wages are really going to start to rise at a very solid basis. So good news there, and of course, a whole second boost to the consumer on top of just the overall sheer number of new jobs, as well as, of course, decreasing prices. Now, when this does start to happen, we still have to keep in mind that it's going to be good to see overall average workers' wages rise. But nevertheless, we still have to be focused on what we call some of those long-term issues of inequality. If you, right here, what I'm showing you here on the left-hand side is real household income by percentile. And you can see, for example, at the bottom 20th percentile, wages on real terms have been more or less flat and indeed have been declining slightly over the course of the last few years. Compare that, for example, to the 95th percentile. Those families have had seen their wages also stagnant over the last 5 or 6 years, but of course stagnant is at roughly at $200,000 or so. So substantially different. And I fear that when we start to see wages rise again, it will likely mainly rise for higher skilled workers. And that's only going to accentuate kind of these long-term inequality issues. And this is also important to lead into the conversation later today when we start talking about the importance of education. Because much of this gap, of course, is occurring largely due to across skill levels. Those who have a college degree or more or a community college degree are doing better. Those, of course, who have not gotten that level of education continue to fall behind on a year-by-year basis. On the right-hand side is net worth, which is a little different measure of inequality. And this looks at the distribution of wealth across households. And here, of course, the problems are even more severe. And I fear, yet again, thinking towards a long-run sort of situation, that when wages start to rise again, it's only going to accentuate some of these already severe problems we have in terms of inequality, something we all have to face. And candidly, raising the minimum wage, while it may be a nice thing to do at the state level, maybe not so much at the city level, will never fully cure issues of inequality. Ultimately, this can only be handled by changes in tax policy, which, of course, given the current political climate in D.C., is a highly unlikely circumstance. As for consumer credit, that has also been expanding recently, which is getting relatively good news. Over the course of the last year, we saw about $400 billion in various sorts of consumer credit, auto loans, credit card loans, things like that. And even the mortgage market is finally starting to turn the corner. Outstanding sort of first mortgage loans actually starting to expand just slightly towards the end of last year. And of course, a home equity line is the only part of the consumer credit accounts that's actually starting to retract at this particular point in time. Now, one of the questions might be, well, is this a good time for Americans to start borrowing again? After all, as we know, Americans had a lot of debt through this last downturn, and we saw a whole bunch of consumer defaults, including, of course, a massive wave of foreclosures. One thing to keep in mind, though, the problems in the consumer markets, those consumer debt markets, over the course of this last credit cycle, was never really due to the quantity of debt. That's got kind of a misunderstanding. It is true in 2007, Americans had a very high debt-to-income ratio. But that was on the back end of years and years of overall interest rate declines. And indeed, the overall debt cost ratio, which is an estimate of the percent of household income being used to support current financial obligations, never really got that high. And more importantly, with interest rates coming down even farther and with households getting rid of some debt over the last few years, you have a situation where the financial obligation ratio today is at a record low level. So Americans can afford to borrow more, and they're starting to borrow more. Again, very good news coming into 2015 from an economic growth perspective. How about industry? How is that doing? Well, you may have heard about this idea that somehow or other the United States is not a country that produces things anymore. That's simply not true. Indeed, right now, industrial production is at an all-time high level. It's growing close to a 4% year-on-year basis. And it is true that things have cooled off just a little bit. We've seen some durable goods orders slow down over the first couple of months of this year. And the ISM indices for manufacturing has gone down until close to 50, but still above 50, suggesting still future growth in overall manufacturing output. Manufacturing is alive and well in the United States, but of course, it's succeeding without hiring a lot of workers. And that's often the key mistake here. People confuse inputs and outputs. If you assume you don't see a lot of new manufacturing employment, that means, of course, that we're not adding a lot of manufacturing output. But manufacturing in the U.S. is surviving today largely on the basis of productivity gains. That is the use of information technology in place of where workers used to do the particular work. That means manufacturing in the United States can succeed in the global marketplace. It can compete with places like China with much lower labor costs. But unfortunately, that means not a lot of new jobs in this particular sector. And of course, manufacturing used to be a place that low-skilled workers could get relatively decent paying jobs. How about business investment? How is that looking? Well, again, business investment actually doing very well. If you look at investment in equipment and intellectual property as a percent of GDP, near an all-time high level right now. And business earnings continue to tick along as well. They've cooled off a little bit over the course of the last couple of quarters, likely because obviously hiring more people and more of that income going to overall workers. That's a good shift, and I'm not really worried about it because profits right now for businesses are close to about 28% higher than they were pre-recession. So businesses are making a lot of money. They have every incentive in the world to continue to invest. And this, again, is going to push us through this particular year. Now, one of the big questions is, what about oil prices? It's interesting. You know, a few years ago, when oil prices were going up, everybody was worried about that and the negative impact. Now that oil prices are going down, I hear a lot of economists worry about that as well because of the potential impact of the economy of the slowdown in production. Well, it has to be one way or the other. You have to be, which way is it? And of course, the answer is ultimately low gas prices, low oil prices are great for the U.S. economy. It is true that oil production is slowing down a lot. Now, on the right-hand side is the Baker rig count, and you can see how that's absolutely fallen off a cliff since oil prices got down to this $50 range or so. But remember, oil exploration is less than about 0.5% of overall industrial production. It really isn't a big share of things. And on the other side of it, think of all the benefits of those cheap oil prices. Yes, your average American household is going to save $700-$800 a year, but that's only a part of it. Think of all the transportation companies out there, UPS, for example, which is going to save tons of money this year on these reduced fuel costs. Think, of course, the airlines are going to be making more money. And I'd love to tell you that means you're going to have cheaper tickets for your airline flights, but anyway, hopefully you own stock in the airlines. And last but not least, farmers. You know, one of the biggest uses of oil in our economy, believe it or not, is for fertilizer in the agricultural sector. And that's one of the biggest costs they face. And again, that is cheaper, good for the farmers. So there's lots of different parts of the economy that are benefiting, and only one part that's really suffering. Added up, clearly this is a net benefit for the U.S. economy. Now, how long is this going to last? Well, it's interesting because what's going on out there has been a fundamental change in how oil is produced. Yes, we all heard about fracking, but what we don't really realize is just the sheer intensity of the productivity gains being created by this new technology. And what it means ultimately is, you know, even though oil exploration is slowing down tremendously at this point in time, actual oil output continues to rise at a dramatic basis. Indeed, the U.S. is almost producing as much oil as Saudi Arabia is right now. We're now producing more than we're importing, which is the first time that's happened in over 30 years. And it's still continuing to grow despite the slowdown in production. It's amazing how this has really changed. And relative to the global economy, it means this really is a truly a new world in terms of oil prices. On the right-hand side is a graph about a study that was done about the new marginal cost curve, if you will, of producing oil, particularly in the U.S. economy, because of fracking. And what it says, basically, is because of all this wonderful new technology we have, the marginal cost per well, if you will, of producing oil is right now about $75 a barrel in the U.S. And because of the sheer ability for us to expand this far beyond what we're already doing, that really puts a functional cap on oil prices at about $75 a barrel. It's not going to go above that for quite some time. So we really are in an era of cheap oil. Now, mind you, I'm still a believer in global warming, and I don't think we should go out and all start driving Hummers again. But I do think it's a wonderful time for us to continue, I don't know, maybe putting a tax on gasoline and using that to rebuild some of our roads, because, you know, that part of the economy is lagging way behind. How about trade? That's one of the big negatives we've seen out there recently. Nominal exports, again, have been falling quite dramatically over the course of the last 6 months or so. But again, a lot of this has to do with the decline in export prices, again, driven by the big decline in commodity prices. Nevertheless, over the last couple months, you really have started to see a slowdown in real exports. And it's not so much that the U.S. economy is not competitive anymore. We really are. Again, go back to this idea of information technology, the use in manufacturing. It really has made the U.S. export sector lean and mean. What we're dealing with out there today is largely having to do with, of course, two things. A weak global economy, and a weak global economy then in turn is putting upward pressure on the U.S. dollar. The dollar, of course, is up about 12% or so. These forces are probably going to be with us for the first 6 months or so of this particular year, maybe for the first 9 months of the year, and that is definitely going to be the one big negative on the U.S. economy. Not big enough to sink our economy, but certainly enough to offset, if you will, some of the gains from other parts of the economy. But what is happening out in the global economy? Probably the biggest issue out there today has to be Europe. But the good news is Europe really has started to turn a corner. If you look at the UK, they're growing nicely. Germany's starting to grow nicely as well. Retail sales are up there. Industrial production is starting to rise. Overall, you saw some decent growth rates there. And mind you, this is all as of the fourth quarter of last year. That's before Europe actually began its aggressive policy of quantitative easing, which is kicking in right now, and a program that should get the banks in Europe lending, again, giving them some more stability. So over the course of this year, with Europe starting to turn the corner, we think that's really going to stabilize the global economy. And we expect the dollar will start to top out probably on mid part of this year and start to drift down again slowly. So what that means is, again, in the short term, we don't see a big risk out there of a major blow up on the world economy. And indeed, towards the end of the year, it will actually start to be a net positive for the U.S. again. Now, one worry, of course, may be Greece. And it is true, of course, with the new government being elected into Greece, you have a situation where suddenly they're talking about renegotiating the bailout, and there's a lot of fears that maybe they end up leaving the EU. But you know, this time it doesn't matter as much as last time. Last time, what started in Greece became quickly an EU-wide problem. That is to say, it wasn't just Greece. It was Italy that caught up in the panic, and it was Spain that got caught up in the panic. And you add that all up, and what ended up happening is it became a global EU problem. This time, that is not happening. These are spreads, these are interest rates on 10-year government bonds. And you can see how on Greek debt has started to rise over the course of the last few months, worries about them actually dropping out of the EU. But it hasn't spilled over to any of these other nations. This time, it really is constrained to Greece. And as a result of that, it really isn't that big of a financial deal, at least in this point in time. How about housing in the United States? Well, as noted on the left-hand side, we did start to see some better things happen towards the end of last year. You know, sales were cooling off when we were here last year during this forecast event. And that cooling off, of course, had to do with the fact that the investors had started to pull out of the market. The big question wasn't so much, was this going to be a new down cycle, but when was the retail investor, that is to say, a person who's going to buy a house and live in it, when were they going to start coming back and start picking up the market again? Well, that did start to occur towards the end of last year, and sales yet again got above about 5 million. Cooled off the last couple months, but I'm going to chalk that up mainly to issues having to do with weather rather than anything fundamental in the market. And indeed, prices, which had kind of slowed down, indeed, for a couple months, almost looked flat, have started yet again to reaccelerate. On the right-hand side here, I'm giving you the Case-Shiller Index, and I'm breaking it down from September of 2013 to September 2014, and then the last 3 months of last year, and I've annualized it, so you're comparing apples to apples. And you can see almost every place in the United States started to see acceleration in home prices, particularly here in California. Los Angeles, for example, accelerated from a 5.6% growth rate to a 12.3% growth rate. San Francisco, from 8% to 18%. So the market really is starting to turn a corner and is yet again on its way up. What's driving it? Well, part of it, of course, has to do with credit really is becoming easier to get. It's still hard, particularly compared to 2005, but it has turned the corner and things are starting to look a little bit better on that particular front. But also important has to do with the fact that with home prices going up, it's created a lot of new equity, almost sort of self-reinforcing process, if you will. That is to say, when prices coming up, we went from about $8 trillion in equity in American homes to almost $13 trillion in equity. And that means people have a lot more money to take out of their existing home and trade up to a new, bigger structure or a brand new structure, as the case may be. Is this starting to have an impact on permits? Well, it does seem to be. Overall, permits have started to reaccelerate again. Right now, we're running about a little less than 1.1 million. Growing slowly, but most of the growth this time is actually in the single-family front. The multifamily front is staying relatively steady at this particular point in time. On the non-residential side, also relatively good news. On a year-on-year basis, overall non-residential spending up about 7% in nominal terms. We're still not quite back to where we were on the pre-recession peak, but overall levels are above where they were back in 2004, 2005. And oh, by the way, spending on some traditional structures like lodging, office, and manufacturing are starting to pick up at this particular point in time as well. So good news on that particular front. The only bit of bad news out there, I think, at this point in time would be public spending, particularly public spending on infrastructure. You probably heard a lot about the fact that revenues are starting to bounce back. But then you look around, you look at our streets, you look at our highways, and you realize, wow, we don't seem to be taking any of this new revenue and putting it into rebuilding, if you will, American infrastructure. Well, this is a real shame. Indeed, the overall number is only about 1.9%. And what it goes back to, I think, is really two things. First of all, while revenues are rising, they're not rising quite as fast as a lot of governments would have hoped. And as a result of that, a lot of that, if you will, deferred spending, which the ways they kind of balance the budget in the short term back when things are really rough, all that money that they didn't spend then, they almost forced to spend now. There's kind of a, if you will, some hidden borrowing going on. But another big part of it, of course, has to do with the fact that now that we're getting into better economic times, you're suddenly starting to see governments, well, they'd have a little extra money. What are you going to do with it? Well, some of that money, of course, is definitely going to those public unions. You've heard all about how these different sort of public entities out there, the LA Teachers Union, for example, asking for an 8% raise. Lots of different unions out there saying, hey, we want our money now. And on top of that, of course, there's all these underfunded pensions, and governments are having to put more and more money into that. The net result of this, of course, is that diversion of these new revenues has to do with the fact that right now public net investment as a percent of overall revenues has fallen to an all-time record low. We are truly not reinvesting in America at this particular point in time, and that's a shame, because I tell you, there's one place where you get a really, there's two places you get really long-term gains to your public dollar. One, of course, is in public education and improving that, and two, of course, is investing in infrastructure. And sadly, those two things seem to be the ones that are being left behind with all this new revenue. How about interest rates and inflation? Could this kind of mess things up as well? Well, as already noted, the big surprise, quantitative easing come to an end, and not only have interest rates not come up, but they've actually come down. Of course, we're dealing with a situation where mortgage rates are getting below 4%, the 10-year treasury is below 2% as well, and banks are extending to lend a little bit more. So suddenly there's more credit available, and that credit's cheaper than it's been before. Again, big boost for this particular year. But where do we expect interest rates are going to be going? Well, in the end, interest rates are really driven by two things. One is inflation or fear thereof, and two, of course, is just basic supply and demand of capital. Well, on the inflation front, there's no sign of inflation. Indeed, despite all the fears of major inflation because of quantitative easing 1, 2, and 3, none of those fears have come true, largely because about 85% of all money generated through QE 1, 2, and 3 never made it into the economy, still sitting in the banks in the form of excess reserves. It's not out there, it's not expanding the money supply, and not in creating inflation. Very good news on that particular front. So in the end, we're really seeing financial markets today driven by pure supply and demand of capital. And now the supply and demand framework, well, we're in great shape. That is to say, we are in a world that is awash with capital. Lots and lots of money out there. Think of all the pension funds borrowing, and they have to invest because they're trying to catch up. Across the developed world, both public and private pension funds, pouring lots of money out there. But on top of that, you have the big one, China. China, second largest economy in the world, still growing 6 to 7% per year, wealth creation machine, a nation that has a 40% savings rate. Well, for years, that money was going to building empty cities in China. That's where all that money was going, infrastructure and cities. But guess what? The Chinese are not so fond of building empty cities anymore, and the infrastructure is getting pretty built out. And suddenly that capital is starting to wheel out of China to the rest of the world. At one level, that's a problem for China. They're trying to work their way through this problem because this is a big shift in internal demand there. But relative to where we are, that money's coming in, and it's here. You can see it at the top level with large Chinese hedge funds buying large parcels of land. You can see it a step down with the EB-5 program. That's the investment visa program, maxed out last year with Chinese money, first time ever. And then go the step down. Think of the houses being purchased across the United States, not the least of here in Southern California. Big money pouring into this nation. All that capital, not a lot of supply, not a lot of demand, and you end up with a situation, of course, where interest rates are going to remain low. Now, eventually, Fed will start to tighten. We probably see it towards the end of this year. And when they start to tighten, it'll come up some. But remember, the spread between the 10-year and the Fed funds right now is less than 200 basis points. They don't have a lot of room to maneuver. Maybe they'll bring it up 50 bips. Maybe they'll bring it up 75 bips. But unless they think the economy is starting to overheat, they're not going to crank it up by much. Interest rates are going to be nice and low. They're going to be here for a while. So what about California? Where are we? You know, it's funny. About 6 months ago, I was with a bond buyer event down in San Diego, and I was with some New York economists from Standard & Poor's, and they wanted me to answer this question. We were on a panel, and they said, looking back a few years, 2009, 2010, everyone was saying California would fail like Greece, Detroit, but things look different now. What has happened to turn things around? Well, the first thing I had to correct them was that this. First of all, not everyone was saying that, okay? And in fact, anybody who said that California is going to fail like Greece or Detroit was only kidding themselves. That's complete nonsense. Is California a bad business climate state? Sure it is. Has it mattered that much in the last 20 years? Not at all. Look, it isn't to say that business climate isn't important. It is. And it's important for everybody in this room, and we should all be out there trying to make our economy easier to work in. And I know that firsthand. I'm a small business person. I get it. But on the other side of things, we continue to hear how business climate is the be-all and end-all when it comes to growth on a state-by-state basis. That isn't true. It is true Texas is business-friendly, and Texas is growing like gangbusters. But that's one example. There's lots of other business-friendly states which, by the way, are not doing well at all. And on the other side of it, again, California, yeah, we had it last for a few years. But before that, we've had gangbuster a decade. Gangbusters despite the downsides of a bad business climate. Why? Because the benefits of being in California outweigh the costs. I know that because people want to be here. And they want to be here because of education. They want to be here because of climate. They want to be here because of location. They want to be here because of the location of some incredibly important industries. And all that adds up to the fact that California is competitive and it is competing. And boy, we're seeing that in those numbers now. Take, for example, these job estimates I was talking about, the revisions we saw there. On the left-hand side here, I'm showing you job growth on a year-by-year basis. Remember, at the beginning of every single year, we get a new benchmark where they basically adjust all the numbers for the previous 15 months. Now, back in 2012, they said, well, you're growing about 2%, but you slowed down towards the end of the year by about 1.5%. And then we got through 2013, new benchmark, and they said, well, actually, you're growing about 2.5%, but now you're slowing down to about 1.5%. This time we mean it. The California miracle is slowing down. And then we got the beginning of 2014, and that didn't seem quite right to us because we saw lots of other good numbers. And lo and behold, they said, well, we got that one wrong too. You were actually growing close to 3.5%. So we were coming in the beginning of this year, and we were sitting around, and the bet we had in my office with my guys wasn't whether or not we were going to get revised up, but how much we were going to get revised up. And we had lots of different sort of numbers out there, who was going to get closest to the truth. Well, in the end, this is what happened. When they revised the numbers up, California grew at over 3%. It's been growing consistently over 3% in terms of payroll job growth now for basically the last 3 years. What that means, of course, is last year, California added 500,000 jobs. That's 100,000 more than Texas. That's one out of every six jobs in the United States. That's our state, folks. We are on fire. Simple as that. This economy is hot. What kind of jobs? Across the board, but relative to the U.S. overall, I'm sorting it by sector, and by growth rate compared to the U.S. Very rapid growth, professional scientific services, real estate's up there, wholesale trade, education, information. As for regions, it's a broad mix, but San Jose, San Francisco on top. But number three is Inland Empire. Beyond that, South Central Valley, including Kern County, doing great there as well. Orange County, Central Coast, and yes, even Los Angeles is in the mix, as Jordan's going to tell us all about in just a minute. Ports are doing well. Yeah, there was a bit of a slowdown in February, but overall trade last year was doing pretty well. Actually, exports from California are growing a little faster than the nation right now. As for residential real estate here, prices continue to grow. Did slow down just a little bit towards the end of last year, but as I already showed you, starting to turn to accelerate again. And really, no foreclosures whatsoever in our economy right now. Indeed, if there's any one major issue that we see in the California economy, it's the growing cost of housing. Housing costs, of course, are becoming more and more expensive. Indeed, relative to the rest of the United States, we're quickly becoming, yet again, one of the least affordable places to live in the United States. And oh, by the way, we have a long ways to go because affordability relative to, say, late 1990s is still relatively good because of these low interest rates. So in fact, from a long-term perspective, believe it or not, we're still very affordable in our own very unaffordable sort of way. Now, ultimately, what's driving these prices up? Unfortunately, the biggest issue is supply and demand, yet again. Simple as that, supply and demand. Or more specifically, the fact that we're not building enough supply to meet demand. We have 12% of the nation's population, yet over the course of the last 20 years, we've built 8% of the nation's building permits. That has driven prices up. It's created one of the worst overcrowded housing situations in the nation. And right here in Los Angeles, it's probably the single worst contributor to issues with the working poor. We don't build enough, as simple as that. Why the shortage? Well, two things, CEQA and Prop 13. CEQA, of course, which allows special interests and NIMBYs to fight tooth and nail against any kind of new development, forcing things to be smaller, causing them to go years before anything actually gets built, then ultimately leaving us with a giant hole. And Prop 13, which constrains the ability of local governments to make money, particularly off of residential properties, which means that the local governments will go along with the NIMBYs and the special interests because they prefer commercial because that brings sales taxes. They don't want residential properties, particularly, God forbid, high-density residential properties. Because you sit down and talk to any manager of a city, he'll tell you that's a big money loser. These two things, simple as that, CEQA and Prop 13. Sadly, nobody in Sacramento is talking about reforming either one of these things. No one's talking about it at all. Instead, they're talking about a $75 fee that'll get us, oh, I don't know, a few thousand affordable housing units over the course of the next year. Well, to put that in context, our state is short something on the order of 750,000 units right now, given our current population situation. 750,000 units. A $75 fee building 7,000 or 8,000 affordable units is a drop in the proverbial bucket. Until you deal with CEQA and Prop 13, you're not going to fix this problem. As simple as that. And to put this in perspective, what does it mean? Well, it means that people leave California. And no, it's not the high-income folks, and no, it's not the entrepreneurs who are leaving. It's lower-income families, the middle class, who are leaving because of property prices. And you see that clearly in the data. If you're making less than $50,000, you're leaving the state. If you're making more than $50,000, you're moving here. And by the way, I'm comparing this to Texas. If you make over $100,000 a year, you're more likely to move from Texas to California than the other way around. Take that, Mr. Perry. Non-residential construction is peaking up because, again, that's the kind of stuff the local government like. That brings revenues, doing better on that particular front. Ag and the drought, interesting, we hear it all the time, the crushing drought. Are we in a drought? No, we're not, at least not yet. Now, that's a weird thing to say because you've heard all the terrible news and the governor's new pronouncements and all that. But a drought is a water shortage that has severe economic consequences. What economic consequences? 3% job growth, incomes are starting to rise, the housing sector's doing fine. Well, what about ag, you say? Aren't they getting clobbered? Well, here's the numbers. Right now, California farm employment, get ready for it, at a decade high level. Right now, we have more workers in agriculture than we've had over the last decade. Farm earnings, 50% higher in 2014 than they were in 2009. This is not a drought, at least not yet. Eventually, we are going to start running out of water. And then we're going to have a problem. But I want to put something in your mind on this particular front. The reason we don't have a drought right now is because we made very smart investments in resources, particularly reservoirs. Reservoirs that collect it when we have the water and use it when we need it. And that's working perfectly. But ultimately, we're starting to run out of that. And we know, of course, in the future, when we do get it, we better be able to collect it quickly. But I want you to put this in mind. You know, we hear all the time about water use in California, and do we use too much of it? Or is it that we don't have enough of it, or is it we use it badly? And the answer is actually we use it badly. Keep something in mind here. In California, 80% of our water that's used is used by agriculture. 20% is used by the urban areas. 20% urban areas, 80% agriculture. Now, if we're a big ag state, that makes sense. We're not a big ag state. Oh, I mean, we're big in the United States, but bear this in mind. Agriculture is 2% of the California economy. Repeat that, 2%. Or in other words, per acre foot of water, we get about $1,500 per acre foot of ag water relative to $215,000 of economic output per acre foot of urban water. That doesn't make sense, folks. To cut off the urban areas is crazy. That's where the state is made or broken. Now, you might say, well, why is Jerry Brown going after urban areas? Why isn't he going after the farms? Well, the answer is if you go after the farms, you go after the federal government, because the federal government runs that water supply, not us. And he can't do that right now. So he's coming after us. But remember, in the long run, this state can prosper. We have plenty of water if we just use it right. And that's not what we're doing right now. Israel and Australia have wonderful economies with much less water, including thriving agricultural sectors. So it's about how we're using the water, not how much we use. Wrapping up real quickly, because I know I'm going over time. State finances looking better, there's no doubt about it. But unfortunately, of course, again, that money's being diverted. It isn't being used for the things we really need to. And of course, remember, most of our new income is being driven by PIT, which is an incredibly volatile source of income. Another downturn, another huge gap out there. Pensions underfunded, healthcare not there as well, and of course, we're not investing in infrastructure, just like the rest of the United States isn't. And indeed, you see some of these numbers out here. One of the things that attracts a lot of companies to California is our infrastructure. But again, we're not making these critical investments. This is an issue. If you want to talk what's going to make California powerful and grow faster, start talking about housing and CEQA reform. Start talking about using water correctly. Start talking about investing in infrastructure. These are the critical issues. These are the things we should be focusing on, not so much on tax rates and or minimum wage. So, add it all up. What are the big themes for this year? Well, again, labor markets are reaching full recovery. Income's about to rise. Consumers are going to continue to spend on better income and easier credit. Housing recovery is already a second rebound. Commercial is rebounding. Business spending is going to grow steadily. The Fed's going to move very slowly. There's no rush because there's no sign of inflation. And our new chairwoman of the Fed is very concerned, particularly about some of those workers who are still on the outside looking in. She's not going to move rapidly. It's nice low interest rates. And California, we are still in the growth mix, at least for now, as long as there's still slack labor out there for us to absorb. But we will come a point in time where our ability to continue to add jobs at a rapid pace is going to be based on us being able to import workers into the state, which we're not going to be able to do if we don't build enough housing. Now, there are some downsides. Obviously, government investments are a constraint. The global economy is still wobbly. State needs housing. We're short, and we need CEQA reform. Our state budget surplus is in name only. There's lots of worries out there about where, what the state financial situation is going to be in. And we can talk about pensions and health care and all that kind of stuff. But you know what's interesting here, and this goes back to what we first started talking about. When you start thinking about many of these problems we face in the medium and long term, you know, the answers are pretty obvious. You don't have to have a PhD in economics to figure these things out. The problem here, of course, is politics. And the fact that we still live in an economy, in a world, where politics really seems completely out of touch with what I would call the real needs of the 90% of Americans. Instead, politics, particularly at the federal level, are being dominated by these firebrands on the left and the right. And that's not good for anybody. So the hope here, and the hope of working with LMU and the Levy Center, is to start bringing these views to the center again and making sure government works for all of us in this particular room. Because the solutions are there. They're not hard as long as we can have honest conversations about them. So with that, I'm going to wrap up, and I'm going to invite Jordan Levine over to start picking up on the LA side of things. Thank you.
How are we doing? Morning, everyone. So yeah, like I said, Chris did most of the heavy lifting, so this is going to be the fun slash easy part, what's happening right here in our backyard. So, you know, for me, that's kind of the funnest thing, because every economy's got its own unique features. But, you know, big themes for the day is that the expansion continues in 2015. We've seen LA's economy continue to move forward. In fact, when you look at most of the major indicators, there's a lot of good things happening. We're definitely not leading the pack by any means, but we're still a huge economic engine for the state nonetheless. And you know, I mentioned a lot of the good news that's out there. You see it from employment to housing markets, business and consumer spending. If you look at tourism, the hotels are busier than ever, the airport's booming, and of course, we've seen lots of good things happening on the construction front. State and local government budgets right here in LA have also started to come back alongside the economy. And so there are a lot of good features about the local economy, despite the fact that we're not out in front of the pack from a growth rate perspective. So for me, I think the big themes for what we want to look for going forward is that, yes, the cyclical stuff is behind us. The economy is moving forward, unemployment's down, jobs are growing. Let's start chipping away at some of these bigger, longer-term structural issues. Chris mentioned pensions, we talked about housing issues, and I want to talk about some of those in the context of LA specifically, because I think we have some of those more exaggerated or acute themes that we cultivated at the state level that are really coming home to roost here in LA. Of course, nonetheless, despite all of those issues, which we need to tackle, we are forecasting that things are going to continue to move forward from a growth perspective. That growth is going to be relatively average, but with some better policies and tackling some of these longer-term structural challenges, we could see that growth accelerate to a faster pace. So let's start with the good news, the jobs front. If you look at the chart on the left-hand side, I usually don't bring charts that show you 25, 30 years of history. I brought that today just to show you that we have not only gotten back to the pre-recession peak of jobs here in Los Angeles County, we're also higher than we were even back at the height of the 01 downturn and getting really close to where we were even back in the 1990s when defense and aerospace were still going relatively strong at that moment in time. If you look on the right-hand side, I'm showing you both surveys, the numbers where they go out and ask firms how many folks work for you, as well as when they ask LA County residents, do you have a job, yes or no? And you can see on both fronts, we've added back more than the 360,000 jobs that we lost during the downturn. In fact, we've added back about 400,000, give or take. So we're about 40,000 jobs higher than where we were, even at the height of that last housing bubble. So things are definitely moving forward on the jobs front. And of course, it's even better than what we were told. We saw the EDD's benchmark revisions, which really boosted up growth in California overall. We saw a lot of that same thing play out here in Los Angeles County, where we saw, you know, previously growth had been estimated to have dropped off to about 50,000 jobs per year for the better part of 2014. Well, fast forward to March when we get these new numbers, and lo and behold, LA County actually maintained about 100,000 job pace for each of the 12 months of 2014. So again, not the fastest growing economy from a growth rate perspective, but still averaging about 100,000 jobs on a year-over-year basis each month of last year. And of course, virtually every sector is on the rise. Reporters call all the time and say, what's the best thing that's happening in the economy right now? Well, for me, one of the most encouraging aspects is the fact that almost every single sector here in LA County is on the rise. Now, we've seen that to differing extents, right? We've created a lot of lower skilled, lower wage jobs and things like tourism, leisure, and hospitality. But you can also see that we've created about 45, 50,000 jobs in things like professional services, in information as well as things like management and some other construction jobs where we have good mid-skill level jobs. So for me, we don't have all of our eggs in one basket, and that's a really encouraging, positive thing. The one exception, or the few exceptions rather, is government, which still hasn't climbed out of the hole that it got into during the downturn. And of course, manufacturing, where we haven't seen the same type of turnaround in jobs here locally that you've seen in other parts of the nation. I think that really highlights one of the areas of specific help that we need to focus on here in LA. And it again comes down to the cost of real estate, the cost of housing, all the challenges associated with CEQA, the permit process, zoning, in terms of getting new manufacturing operations online. And we've seen that perhaps more than other places here in LA. Of course, unemployment's also down, right? We're down below 8% here in LA County. That's slightly ahead of the state overall. But that unemployment rate has come down from the high 12% range at the bottom of the downturn. For me, what's more important is not just that that unemployment rate is down, but that it's down for the right reasons. So the unemployment rate can move around for all sorts of reasons, sometimes because folks are becoming discouraged and dropping out of the labor force. That's not the case here in LA. In fact, we've added a couple hundred thousand individuals to the labor force, and the unemployment rate has come down despite that. So this isn't some statistical anomaly. The unemployment rate is down due to genuine improvements here on the ground in LA County, and that's a real positive. Now for the bad news, right? We're lagging. Don't get too excited. When you look at how we stack up to the rest of the state, yes, we saw the job growth numbers revised up to about a 2.5% pace. That's still below the statewide average, which is above 3% for the better part of 2014. What I'm showing you on the right-hand side is growth rates by industry compared to California. And so the ones above that red line, those are the sectors where we're outpacing the state overall in terms of jobs. We've seen government come back, our retail sector is still growing faster than what you see in the state overall, but virtually every other sector is growing slower. So it's not just isolated to manufacturing not doing as well, although that's a big part. It's not just that construction's not growing as fast, although again, that is another contributor. It's that, you know, a lot of these industries here in LA aren't growing. They're growing, but they're just not growing at the same pace that you see in other states. And I think the ones that I highlighted down at the bottom are ones that are particularly concerning: professional, scientific, technical, construction. These are sectors that either A, pay good wages or provide a good source of opportunity for mid-skilled folks, and those are things that we want to see turn the corner a bit quicker. And of course, the other part is not just that we're not growing faster or as fast as the state overall. I think that the growth has not been evenly spread. So if you remember back to the first slides, I showed you that yes, LA has added back all of the jobs that we lost during the downturn. You can see that here on this chart. We're about 49,000 jobs higher than what we were at the height of the last bubble. That said, what I've done here is I've sorted this by industry. And so the sectors up at the top there, manufacturing, construction, finance, government, these are all industries that are to some extent below where they were despite the fact that we've recovered all of our jobs. They're not the same jobs that we lost during the downturn. Construction workers, still a lot of unemployed construction workers out there. Same thing with retail trade. Now you flip to the other end of the spectrum, tourism. We have more tourism jobs today even than what we had at the height of the last bubble. Same thing on the professional side. Management, logistics, these are all sectors where we've added back more than the jobs lost, and they're higher than they've ever been before. So although we've gotten back to peak, it depends on what type of work you do, what occupation, what industry you're in. to determine what type of recovery you're experiencing. And so that's why you get these comments and kind of trends where folks don't feel like we're in an economic recovery, but then the data seems to show that we have recovered all of the jobs. And I think that's, you know, really gets down to the nitty-gritty of the nuance, and not all jobs are created equal. The economy that we have today doesn't look like the economy that we had back in 2007, and that's going to be a continued source of challenge as we move forward, despite the fact that we're quote-unquote recovered by this point in time in LA. Of course, taking all those bad things along with the good, I think perspective is key, right? LA is still an economic engine. So I mentioned and alluded to the growth rates, where we're not growing as fast as other parts of the state. In fact, you can see it on this chart compared to San Francisco, San Jose, which have added back 20% or expanded their jobs by 20% since the end of the downturn. LA's only expanded by about 10%, right? So we're growing about half the clip of the Bay Area. But when you translate that over into the number of jobs, because we're such a big metro in the state, we've got over 4 million jobs here locally. We've still added more jobs than San Francisco and San Jose put together, right? And that's a critical takeaway. Yes, we haven't seen the growth rates, but we have contributed more jobs to the state's economic recovery than San Jose and San Francisco put together. That is a critical point. So despite the fact that we have our issues and we need to address them, we are still a major economic engine in the state overall. Of course, worker wages have been relatively lackluster. We talked about that at the state level. It's true here in Los Angeles County as well. I've sorted again the sectors that are seeing wages grow by more than the state overall on the right-hand side, which is everybody above that red line. These are sectors where we are seeing some wage growth, in fact, more than what we're seeing in the rest of California. But there's a couple of sectors which tend to be some of the larger sectors here in LA, which aren't seeing the same types of wage growth. Construction, which isn't growing as fast as what we see in other parts of the state. Manufacturing, again, still seeing some wage growth, but just not the pace of wage growth that you see in other parts. And of course, that's a bigger issue as we start to think about things like housing costs and growing inequality. But it's not just the labor markets, right? Labor markets tend to be a lagging indicator. At Beacon Economics, we, you know, do, I think, what most businesses do, is you wait to see business pick up, and then you go out and start making your hires. You don't kind of go out and hire a bunch of individuals and then say, man, I really hope we generate a lot of sales this year. And so I think that it's important to keep perspective on those jobs numbers that are really reflecting what we've seen happen over the course of the last year, whereas some of these forward-looking things are going to tell us what to expect coming down the pike. The good news there is that things are almost better than what you see on the job front. We're a huge market for outsiders, and you can see that in the business activity numbers. On the left, I'm showing you taxable sales by businesses and consumers and tourists. And what you can see is that those have bounced well back ahead of where they were even at the peak of the last bubble, and are now at their all-time high levels. Of course, when you look at how that's distributed across the county is a very diverse place. We heard Supervisor Knabe talk about the 88 incorporated cities and the huge unincorporated area. Well, the good news is that to varying degrees, each part of LA County is in fact feeling the expansion locally. The one exception to that is the South Bay, which had a good year in 2013. So it's pressing down those growth rates into 2014. But virtually across the board, it's unanimous that businesses and consumers are spending more money. And that's been a trend that we've seen continuing since about mid-2009. So really good news on the spending front. Businesses should be doing better. I talked about the tourism numbers, and of course, tourism and hotels are doing better than they've ever done before. Hotel occupancies are higher than they were even before the downturn, and not only that, we're renting out those rooms at higher and higher rates. So great time to be in the hotel business. You look at the airports, they're still flush with people. In fact, we had one of the stronger growing airports. We've made a lot of work and progress on the state of our airport, and you can see that those numbers are still relatively strong. In fact, we're ahead of the state overall, over 70 million passengers here at LAX last year. So that's a big driver of what's contributing to growth in the hotel side, and we're still a top tourist destination here in LA. That's gonna be a feather in our cap for years to come. And of course, this was a great year for venture capital. We're not necessarily always known for a center of venture capital activity, but we saw huge growth multiple double-digit growth in venture capital investments to the tune of about $2 billion last year. Some very notable companies that really kind of show how LA's economy is changing, right? A lot of tech companies. We hear a lot about Silicon Beach. In fact, right down the road, we know that I think Google and Yahoo are building a big campus with a lot more technology jobs. You see companies like Snapchat, ZipRecruiter, Prodigy, you know, a lot of these high technology firms receiving a lot of venture capital investment right here in LA. So this isn't just limited to the Silicon Valleys of the world. You're starting to see LA throw its hat in the ring in terms of technology as well. And that's something that we're gonna see bearing fruit as these investments kind of come to fruition over the next couple of years. Of course, the ports are a mixed bag. We heard that 2014 was a decent year for exports. We didn't see a ton of export growth, but we didn't see a huge contraction in exports. That said, you can see over on the right-hand side the effect of the port shutdown and how those containers really dropped off a cliff in February. We started to see those pop back up in March, you know, and I don't think that it's going to be a sustained trend that we're going to see at the ports, but keep in mind that the ports are generating a lot of economic activity outside of LA County as well, places like the Inland Empire where a lot of these distribution logistics centers are. So hugely important for California as an asset. You know, the short-run economic implications of what it's going to do to jobs and spending, I think, might be a bit overstated. Nonetheless, we've started to see those container counts rise again as that shutdown's gone by. For me, one of the biggest issues that we have here in LA is housing, and I think this is something that we could spend, you know, hours just talking about housing and manufacturing here in LA, because I think it's such a specific issue that we have, and it's one of the biggest ones that we're facing today. So cyclically, things are much improved, right? We saw double-digit declines in home prices to the tune of about 40-50% during the downturn. Home prices have stabilized, that's a fact. If you look on the left-hand side, you can see that home prices have trended up. Yes, we're not back to that $600,000 median price that we hit back at the height of the last downturn, but we have grown into about the $450,000, $500,000 range, depending on whether you're looking at the whole housing market or just single-family homes. Of course, that's led to a big reduction in the number of defaults and foreclosures. If you were going to foreclose because you were upside down on your home, a lot of that's already happened. You don't go and default on your mortgage when home prices are rising by 15, 20% per year. So the worst of the downturn in the cycle is behind us. But I think structurally is where we've got a lot of challenges moving forward. So on the left-hand side, I'm showing you the Wells Fargo Housing Price Index. And what you can see is that the top 10 most expensive housing markets in the nation, five of them are right here in California. And that includes LA, which is about on par with New York City in terms of the cost of a home. How does that compare to other places, right? We're constantly being compared to Texas and other places along the Western United States. And that's where they've got us beat hands down. I don't think it's necessarily the business friendliness that drives the show. It's the fact that it's so much cheaper to do business in some of these other states. So at our $450,000 median price, you're talking about $175,000 more than what you spend to live even in the Inland Empire, right? Which is just 50, 60 miles down the road. And it's about 2.5 times more than what you see in some of Texas's largest markets, Dallas, Austin, things like that. So for me, this is an area where they've got us beat hands down, and why they can afford to be so much more business friendly is because it doesn't cost the workers as much money to live there. So that's one of the biggest challenges I think that we face going forward and what it does to the cost of doing business. Of course, the rental markets are no picnic either. You look at vacancy rates across the board. I know this is a horrible chart that I should have shrunk down all these names or changed up, but the takeaway for me is that no matter what market you're looking at, and I know you can't read what markets those are, but the point is that no matter what market you look at across LA County, you're looking at a vacancy rate of between 1% and 6%. So not a lot of fat out there in the region's housing markets. We just simply don't have enough housing. You're looking at rents anywhere from $1,000 a month in some of the most affordable markets, all the way upwards of $2,500 to $3,000 a month. So housing market is tight, and the housing market is expensive, and that's one of the biggest challenges we face in terms of recruiting businesses here, enabling them to offer their workers a salary that enables them to get a good quality of life and all the ripple effects that are associated with that. And that's something that we definitely have to nip in the bud. What's the problem? Well, I'm showing you on the left-hand side is that we don't have enough vacancies as a share of overall housing stock. We have one of the lowest vacancy rates of any of those markets that we looked at in any of our states or even in our neighbors in the Inland Empire. And what the real problem is that we just have not kept pace with population growth. So on the right-hand side, I think this is one of the most telling charts about the fundamental issues in LA County's economy. I'm showing you the number of new residents that have moved into LA in five-year blocks compared to the amount of new housing that we built in those same five-year blocks. And so you can see in LA, we're running somewhere around 4.5 to 5.5 times as much new residents as what we're getting in terms of new housing. Now, we caught up a bit during the downturn, but between 1995 and 2000, we added 235,000 residents. We only built 50,000 new homes. Same thing in 2000, in the height of the housing bubble out to 2004. We had almost 500,000 new residents, and we built about 100,000 new homes, right? So we are just not keeping pace, and this doesn't take into account our replacement needs, right? There's a lot of housing stock that's also just aging out that needs to be replaced over time, and that doesn't take into account that. This is just based purely on new population. So you can see that the need for housing is acute, and that's one of the reasons why you see us continually climb up those ranking tables in terms of how expensive it is to live here. It's a supply and demand issue. You know, we've seen a lot of things come down the pike to try and address this, but really it comes down to a supply and demand issue. I broke this down sub-regionally so you can see how it plays out across the county. When you look at folks that are behind the curve the most, you see it's a lot of the peripheral areas, the areas that surround the core urbanized areas where they've seen some new population growth coming online, Huntington Park, but they just haven't built enough housing units. And this is just looking out over the last 5 years. So there's some areas that are gonna have more and more need as folks escape these higher home prices and go into more affordable areas. We haven't seen those affordable areas turn around and create the commensurate amount of housing to keep those prices under control. So those areas are poised for ongoing growth in home prices if they can't rise to meet that demand. And you fast forward to the other end of the spectrum, and you can see some of the urban areas in the South Bay, West Hollywood, Beverly Hills, Santa Monica, most parts of the South Bay, including LA City in there, are doing a pretty good job over the last 5 years of building new housing and prepping for that kind of urbanized growth that we've seen being transitioned to recently. More on the consequences is just how much it costs us to live here. So we talked about it being anywhere from 1.5 to 2.5 times more expensive to live in some of those markets. But you compare our median incomes, they're not that much different, right? We're all somewhere in the $50,000, $55,000 a year median income range. So what that all adds up to is that we're spending a huge chunk of our income relative to other areas just on your cost of housing and what that does to, you know, the cost of business and the wages that folks are going to require to work here in LA. And of course, you see that those are the folks that are the most pressed when you look at out-migration from LA County. The vast majority of the out-migration is folks making somewhere between $40,000 a year all the way up to $150,000 a year. So these are folks who would otherwise potentially be buying homes in LA County who are instead leaving for places like the Inland Empire, other states, other parts of California like the Bay Area, which are seeing faster job growth. But, you know, the Inland Empire is picking up a big chunk of those, as is North Orange County in places like Anaheim, Placentia, and things like that, where it's more affordable. You still have access to those jobs, but you don't have to spend an arm and a leg to get that home. So the response thus far I would, you know, characterize as Band-Aid solutions. We talked about raising the minimum wage. We've talked about affordable housing measures, and I think those are important. But keep in mind that this isn't just a low-income phenomenon, right? When we talk about the folks who are being driven out of LA, they're making $50, $60, $75, $80,000 a year. These aren't the people that are going to be helped by affordable housing measures. So we need housing, period, affordable and otherwise. We just need more housing units, full stop. The good news is that construction is ramping up, and you can see the number of residential units in LA County on the right-hand side that I'm showing you. Problem is that we got a huge hole to climb out of over those multiple decades of just not building enough housing. And of course, the real solution is to build more housing, looking at CEQA, looking at NIMBYism, looking at our zoning rules, our permit processes, doing whatever we can to enable more units to come online. And of course, until we do that, you know, I said the Inland Empire is laughing all the way to the bank as they take our high-income, high-skilled residents. They use that to puff up their own property tax, sales tax base, and then we have them commute across the county line to come work at our jobs. You know, and I think that's all the impetus we need to get this thing under control and to address the housing issue overall. Commercial markets are mixed. We've seen vacancy rates come down, but most of the activity still in terms of adding or fixing up existing space. We haven't seen a huge turn. They're coming down, but we still have elevated vacancy rates, and the commercial markets are still trying to adapt to the kind of changing urban outlook for LA, as well as the differing ways that we do business with telecommuters, people working remotely, the internet, and things like that. So they're still moving forward, but much more mixed bag than the residential side. Of course, on the forecast side, we see things continuing to move forward. We have about 2.5% job growth over the next couple of years. Home prices are going to be somewhere in that 4-6% range, and we're going to see continued permit activity. But I'm not confident that we've made the changes yet to really get ahead of the curve in terms of that new housing and maintain or kind of get under control those housing costs. So things are looking up. Everything's moving forward. When you look at all the cyclical stuff, spending, jobs, unemployment, you name it. And so now it's time to tackle those long-term challenges. First on and foremost is housing. And I think running a close second is infrastructure and education. Now we're making some strides on that front, right? We're looking at fixing up the airport. We've expanded and taken out some bond measures to expand the metro lines. And I think those are all positive things. But those need to be a continued focus, particularly as we transition out of a crisis management mode, and now we're in an expansion mode. Let's start to chip away at some of these longer term issues while we have the kind of luxury to tackle those before we get into the next cycle. So thank you so much. We're pretty optimistic about LA, and we expect growth to accelerate through the end of the year.
All right. Good job.
Chris made reference to this. This is our approach in terms of forecasting at LMU. We see that we believe that for you to make an informed decision, you need a triad of information. You need the economic data that both Chris and Jordan have greatly presented. We also believe, and that tells you what's happening. And you could certainly get a sense of what is happening with that data that they provided. Second, you need to know what people think is happening, and that's the residential forecast or the public opinion that we're going to present to you. And third, we want you to know what leaders want to happen, and that's our third component. So we've brought these three together to be able to give you a complete, the triad of information that we believe really helps you in terms of making decisions. What we have on page 13, and this is a very busy slide, all you really need to know about this slide is that it's very reflective of the county of Los Angeles. And this is, of course, a population of over 18 years. We obviously didn't interview children. And so the only difference that you would see with this demographics and the general demographics is that it's a little less Latino and a little bit more white because children are not counted here. You could take a real close look at this in your book. I'm not going to spend much time on it, but just to let you know that our sampling turned out to be very, very good. On page 15 in your books, you have this slide, which is the demographics of the city managers. As you recall, last year we interviewed 60 of the 88 mayors. This year we interviewed 57 of the 88 city managers in the county of Los Angeles. Basically, they are the CEOs of the municipal and corporations of Los Angeles County. And you can see their demographics here. A couple of things stick out. I think Supervisor Knabe mentioned it in terms of the gender. 95% of our city managers are male, few females. I think of the 88, only 5 are females. That means 83 males. Number two, only 2 African-American city managers and only 2 Asian-American city managers. Latinos seem to be doing quite well within this. Number three, the education level. As we expect, they have much higher education levels than the residents. Number four, age. 88% of our city managers are over the age of 45. And then finally, one thing that caught my eye was the marital status. If you want to stay married, marry a city manager. 95% is really very, very high. And just a couple of, as I mentioned, they are very different than last year. So when we show you the data in the next couple of slides that compare leaders between 2014 and 2015, remember that we're comparing city managers to mayors from last year. And mayors tend to be a little bit more diverse as our elected officials. And we do have a couple of elected officials that are here. I see Mike Eng, who is currently on the Los Angeles Community College Board, was on the was at the State Assembly, and then previously was on the City Council in Monterey Park. He's here. Mike Davis, former Assembly member over there. He's also on the Public Works Commission. And two of his colleagues are also here, Kevin James and Monica Rodriguez. We also have either mayors or council members from Luis Ayala from Alhambra, Jorge Morales from Southgate, Antonio Lopez from San Fernando, Chris Garcia from Cudahy, Eloy Morales from Inglewood. And of course, we also have one of my colleagues, Dave Roberti, who was president pro tem of the state senate for 10 years, the second most important position in the state of California, also my team teacher when I teach California politics, and an alum of Loyola Marymount University. Dave Roberti. Back to demographics. These next two slides show the demographic shift that have occurred both in the city and the county of Los Angeles. This is the county and this is the city. And basically, very similar that they look, incredible diversity that you've seen over the last 40 to 50 years, and some projections if you just simply extrapolate the lines. Number one, this is the most ethnically diverse region in the history of humankind. No other region in the world, in the past or the present, is more diverse in terms of using a variety of different measures that I just can't go into. You can take our word for it, but we have a research paper that talks about this. Number one, the most diverse. Number two, you can see the Latino population is now over 50% in both the city and the county. In absolute numbers, there are more Latinos in Los Angeles City or Los Angeles County than any city or county in the country. Number two, in absolute numbers, and people can constantly forget this, in absolute numbers, this is the second largest white city in America. Only New York has more whites than Los Angeles. Number three, Los Angeles County is the largest Asian county in America. No county has more Asians than Los Angeles. Number four, it's one of the top 10 cities and counties in terms of the African American population. Again, incredible diversity. Los Angeles is the region that has the most Mexicans outside of Mexico, the most Canadians outside of Canada, the most Koreans outside of Korea, the most Filipinos outside the Philippines, the most Armenians outside of Armenia. I can go on for the rest of my presentation to finish that. You can see that there's an incredible, incredible diversity. Part of that diversity, of course, in this incredible demographic shift includes white flight. And what we're going to do right here is forecast the end of white flight. And you can see the numbers and how they has begun to stabilize. There are 1.2 million whites in the city, 2.5 million whites in the county. We do not see the decline of whites under 1 million occurring in the city or under 2 million occurring in the county within the next two decades. We do not expect them to drop below 20% of the population. And so you're going to get an incredible stability. What does this incredibly diverse population think about Los Angeles? What do they think about their future? Well, they're incredibly optimistic. This is a question that we have asked every single year that we have done surveys, and we've been doing surveys since 1997. We simply ask, how do you think things are going, in the right direction or wrong direction? And what you have here is both the 2014 and 2015. And you can see that people are very optimistic that Los Angeles is going in the right direction, that the region is going in the right direction, and that their neighborhood is going in the right direction. Two patterns that we always find. Number one is that the more you know about the situation, the more optimistic you are. And that is people know about their neighborhoods. And they're very optimistic about the direction of their neighborhoods. If you aggregate the neighborhoods, of course, that makes up the county. But when we ask them about the county, it's a more of an abstraction. It's further away. They know about their neighborhoods, but they've heard stories about one other area or another. And you don't get as high an optimism, but it's still very high. So point number one, this pattern, we consistently see it in every survey that we've ever asked. It's always more about the neighborhood. You get the same dynamic when you ask about, you know, do you love Congress? People hate Congress, but they love their congressman. All right? You're getting this very same dynamic here. That's pattern number one. Pattern number two, of course, is that you saw an improvement in just 1 year. In just 1 year. Now, two data points don't make a trend, but we've asked this question since 1997 for the city. Here we're giving you the county results on this one. But we've asked this question in 97, in 02, in 2007, 2012, et cetera, and you clearly see the trend line that people are much more optimistic about Los Angeles for a variety of different reasons that both Chris and Jordan were talking about. And we also, of course, have this data by ethnicity. In here you can see the differences between the four major ethnic groups. And you can see the difference in 14 and 15. Two important points about this data. Again, it's on page 19 of your book. But number one, you do see the improvement over the last year. Number two is every single survey that we've done and have asked this question, we get Latinos and Asian Americans much more optimistic than whites and African Americans. As a matter of fact, we call the Latinos and the Asian Americans the leading indicators of optimism. They will lead the optimistic index, and whites and African Americans will follow. And here you can even see that in, for instance, whites in 2015, 61% of them believe the region is going in the right direction. That's the same number that Latinos were at last year. And that's what I mean by being the leading indicators of what is happening. On page 20 and 21 of your books, you can see questions that household finances, how people feel about whether things are going to improve for them financially. And you can see, the beginning of the optimism picking up, okay? And so there's stability over the 2 years in terms of the finances, and we'll see unemployment as well. There are minor ethnic variations, but overall, the population feels somewhat stable in terms of these numbers. They do see some improvement happening in the near future. You see the reality that Chris and Jordan talked about, and you see people picking that up in these numbers overall. Regarding unemployment, it's divided. You can see somewhat ambivalent. About a third think that it will increase, about a third think it will stay about the same, and about a third think that it will decrease. And these numbers didn't change very much from 14 to 15. Now, in a low interest, low inflation environment, staying about the same isn't necessarily bad, but certainly we can see a little bit better numbers as the reality of what Chris and Jordan talked about begins to impact the region. People will pick that up. Okay. On page 22 of your books, the results of what we believe is the major issue facing not only the Los Angeles region, but all of America, and that is economic disparity. Do you think the growing economic disparity between the rich and the poor will increase, stay the same, or decrease? 54% in 2014 thought it would increase, a little bit of an uptick in terms of increase for 2015. However, if you take a look at the decreasing side, over 18% compared to 13% believe it will decrease. And this is not an optimistic indicator, and even when you take a look at leaders, in 2014, the mayors, 50% of them thought that we would get an increase in economic disparity. In 2015, the city managers, 63% of them believe that this economic disparity would increase. I believe this is the major challenge that's impacting not only Los Angeles, but all of the urban America. One of the things that's being driven by this, especially in Los Angeles, and you clearly saw with the stuff that the data that Chris and Jordan gave you, is housing and the affordability. Let me go right here. So page 26 and 27 has this results for you. Do you believe housing prices will increase, stay about the same? 69% last year, 70% believe that housing prices are gonna increase. And Chris, his data and Jordan's data certainly point to that. And so very stable type of numbers there. Do you think, here's a question we ask consistently, do you think the majority of residents in your city can afford to buy a home? And only 17% last year and 20%, a little bit of an uptick, of residents believe they could afford a home in their city, okay? Take a look at the numbers for the leaders. 38% of the mayors last year and only 32% of the city managers who know their cities quite well believe that people can afford to buy homes in their cities and in their residents. A very pessimistic number. We believe that part of the economic disparity is being driven by housing prices. You saw some, you saw Chris and Jordan continuously talk about we have to build more homes, we have to reform CEQA, et cetera. And you can certainly see it here in the opinions that really this is probably the most negative numbers that we have. If you go back and take a look at home ownership, and we ask people, do you plan to buy a home? 18% of respondents plan to buy a home, and we ask a variety of different other housing questions that we don't have time to go through here, but there is an intention. 26% of renters still would like to buy a home. And this was that they were thinking about a home next year. This is not to say we didn't ask the question about in 3 years or 5 years. So there is pent-up demand. There is the desire to buy the home. It's the affordability question. And even homeowners who are thinking about moving up or buying an additional home, 12%, there's somewhat of a pent-up demand there. And so it speaks and it really couples that data together very well with what we were talking about. So in addition to a lot of economic questions, we ask all kinds of variety of different social civic questions that are in the minds of voters and in the minds of residents. And these are two. We have many others, but we just wanted to pick on these two. Do you consider you and your family earthquake prepared? We brought this question up because Mayor Garcetti's been talking quite a bit about earthquake preparedness, and he's been very proactive about this, which we think is a smart thing to do. But you could see that a third of Angelenos do not believe that they are prepared. Okay, over a third. Somewhat prepared, 32%. And yes, that's an impressive number. I was actually expecting that number to be much lower, but it's good to hear that 32% of Angelenos are getting ready for the big one. And this is just to remind you that this is an issue that could happen at any second, but Angelenos feel that they, are about a third of them are prepared. Second, another issue, we've discussed about it. Do you feel Los Angeles is prepared enough for future drought conditions? Only 15% of Angelenos believe that we're prepared for that. And so they're taking it seriously. Obviously, Governor Brown talked about the urban cutbacks last week, and so this was very prevalent. 59%, close to two-thirds, believe that we are not prepared enough. And I have to disagree with Chris. I do think we're in a drought. He defines it very, very different. I define it that I couldn't go skiing when I wanted to go skiing. I can't water my lawn anymore, et cetera. Chris, there is a drought. And so we have a very different definition of that. Now, the next slide. Angeleno identity. Well, we believe strongly that there is a new identity being developed. We have in your books on those pages, I combined page 32 and 33 in terms of this graph. Also on there are some of the quotes. If you take a look at the front of the book, it asks people, we asked the question, do you consider yourself an Angeleno, number one? And we then follow up that question, what does it mean? Okay, I mean, we can't even define what the word is or even how to spell it. And yet we're asking people to do that. On that board, under that great lion right there, is a variety of different definitions that people gave us. And we've also asked people, including Supervisor Knabe and others, have gone up there and put down or written down what they believe an Angeleno is. We invite you to do that, not while I'm speaking, but a little bit later, if you find yourself over there, to write your comments. Think about, what does it mean to be an Angeleno? But it's impressive that 77% of the residents of the county, remember, this is the county, this is not just the city. If we do the city only, it goes up into the 80s, okay? But so 77% of people in the county consider themselves Angelenos. And what's interesting, of course, is that, again, Latinos and Asians consider themselves to be more Angeleno than whites and African Americans. And what's even more interesting than that is if you're foreign born, you consider yourself to be more of an Angeleno than if you are US born. And that cuts across all ethnic lines. Foreign born Latinos consider themselves, 89% of them consider themselves Angelenos. 85% of foreign-born Asians, African-American foreign-born, and white foreign-born. So being foreign-born, coming to Los Angeles, you find your home here. There's much more a feeling of a home in Los Angeles for a variety of different ethnic groups. As a matter of fact, when Mayor Garcetti was going after the Olympics, one of his pet comments was that everybody will have a hometown advantage because they all have fans here for every single country. That's why we should bring the Olympics here since the world's already here and they have many people to cheer for them. Maybe what it means to be an Angeleno is a super liberal. Okay. So what, you know, none of the national wedge issues that we see on Fox News and MSNBC are really playing themselves out in Los Angeles. They've all, in a sense, there's no debate here. This is basically Rachel Maddow country in LA. And you can certainly see it here. This is on page 34 of your books. We all know that Republicans are disappearing. And, you know, they're an endangered species, and environmentalists and liberals don't seem to care about that. Okay? Over less than 30% of registered voters in California are now Republican. Less than 20% of registered voters in Los Angeles County are now Republican. Registered voters in the city of Los Angeles are only at 15%. Okay? And so you see a tremendous shift in partisanship, but also in ideology. What's interesting is that we also had in the demographics of the residents, we asked people, do you consider yourself liberal, conservative, et cetera? About a third of the individuals consider themselves conservatives, but yet when we ask them specific questions, it doesn't appear that way. Okay, and so what we see here are these are the wedge issues that you constantly find in the debates. Now people say, well, what is feminism? Our point here is we didn't define feminism. We just let the individuals define it and whether they support it or not. And the same with immigrant rights, et cetera, and the minimum wage that we talked about. Look at gun control, 76% more gun control. This is an incredibly, incredibly liberal city and region. And it's quite impressive that there's a consensus. And that has ramifications, obviously, for politics. It's very difficult for you, if you're a conservative, to and take any conservative positions. You're basically going to go against the residents and the voters. And that's why we get the type of politics that we do in Los Angeles, with two very liberal individuals running against each other for mayor, Congress, or what have you. While there are concerns, economic disparity, housing affordability, Angelenos are very satisfied with their neighborhoods. Let's see, there we go. And so we have a long list of questions that we ask people about their levels of satisfaction. For each item, how would you rate the characteristics as a whole using a scale of good, fair, and poor? And we're talking about a variety of different, and we're going to be tracking this for many years. One of the things that we're very impressed with is public transportation, how 48% of Angelenos and 35% think it's fair, 48% think it's good. We're not talking about traffic and mobility. Notice how that's way down below. We try to separate those two out to gather that. Had you talked about that, let's say 10, 15 years ago, people would not have been as optimistic or as supportive of public transportation. But certainly that investment that we've been making in public transportation has been paying off. On every specific type of question, leaders or city managers had higher levels of satisfaction, which of course makes sense because they're the ones running these type of things. But again, I can't go through every single one of these. They're in your books. And you could see that there are challenges, especially access to affordable housing and homelessness. You see those two at the bottom there. Again, it reinforces the data that Chris and Jordan were talking about. How satisfied are you in your neighborhood? We saw that how much people are much more thinking that their neighborhood's going in the right direction compared to the city and the county. Here we get a little bit more specific. Overall, is it a great place to live? 98% of the leaders obviously believe that it's a great place to live. That's they represent. They work there. But 86% of the public, okay, 86% of Angelenos like their place overall. That's a high number of satisfaction. 86% believe it's a safe place to live. And public safety is always the number one issue for local governments. It's always the number one issue that drives local politics. And you can see that it's a very high number. Again, overall, the last one there, overall quality of life, 84% of the public and 94% of the leaders believe that there's a high quality of life in their neighborhoods. Again, very, very supportive. If someone was interested in moving to where you live, would you recommend it? 81% of residents said yes. 83% of residents said yes in this year. So again, a little bit of an uptick, only 1 year difference, but you can see that people are becoming more positive about recommending their neighborhoods. Okay, 83%. Then a few little comments about the city managers. Again, we interviewed 57 of the 88 city managers, and we asked them all kinds of different questions. We're going to release a much broader report later on, but one of the things we asked them about was, which legislative body is the most influential over the economic future of your city? As you can see, all of them talk really about the mayors. 56% of them thought, of course, they were the city. But even the city managers, 63%. And that they believe in their ability to affect change, obviously. We're not surprised by the findings. We are surprised by the LA County Board of Supervisor finding. Only 3%, basically one city manager thought that the county board was the most influential, and none of the city managers. I'm glad Don Knabe had to go to his board meeting not to see this, but we think he's very important, but most of the mayors and city managers don't think that he's nearly as important as their city councils. And then for Congress, you could see that the state legislature is much more important to local leaders than the members of Congress. Again, just focusing on the city managers and what they had asked, what they believe. Where do businesses relocating to your city generally come from? This is problematic. Chris alluded to this, that 83%, this is the belief, this is not hard data, but this is asking city managers, when a new business arrives in your city, where does it come from? 83% of them, or they believe that 83% of businesses come from within LA County. Only 10% come from other parts of California. Only 6% comes from out of the state. We're not necessarily creating new jobs or a new tax base for the county. We're just moving from one border to the other. Again, problematic. It again goes with some of the challenges that both Chris and Jordan talked about. How likely is it for your city to raise the minimum wage beyond the California state minimum wage? 43% and 41%, not very likely, not likely at all. So 84% of the city managers, meaning most of the rest of LA County, is not going to talk about raising the minimum wage. We've heard Mayor Garcetti has his proposal. The city council has made a minimum wage or a livable wage at the airport, the Century Corridor, other hotels over a certain amount of number. You heard Don Knabe talk about LA County is going to take a look at this issue. Long Beach, West Hollywood, and Santa Monica have also taken on the issue. It's a major discussion, but city managers don't feel that it's going to resonate in their cities or that they're not going to take it up. It's not something that the typical city in Los Angeles County is going to look at. However, we did see in that previous liberal chart that over 81% of LA residents believe that the minimum wage should be raised. People may bicker in terms of how we ask the question. They also may say we didn't provide a lot of context in terms of the nuances of raising the minimum wage. But at the gut level, when you ask residents of LA, they strongly believe that the minimum wage should be raised. And you clearly see that. And there's no turning the corner in many of these social issues. When they get that high, you're going to constantly have that response. So the proponents of increasing the minimum wage have tremendous allies in the residents and the voters of Los Angeles. It's up to them, the leadership, to then structure how that is presented to them. And here you see that much of that leadership is not going to present that to most of the local cities. And it goes back to Chris's point. It's going to have to be at the county and or at the state level, because most cities will not deal with the minimum wage question. And then finally, we know the disappearance of the redevelopment agencies, and we asked quite a few of those questions to the city managers, but we asked them this question about the MTA is considering putting a countywide measure on the ballot, what we're calling Measure R2, that would extend Measure R from its current 30-year limit. Would you support that? And 71% say they will support that. And 27% are still thinking about this. We asked very similar results, a little bit higher from the mayors last year. And what we see here is that cities are struggling to try to find economic development tools. And when you saw the data that Chris and Jordan presented, you could see that government is lagging. We have the pension problems, but we also have the problems of how to have cities invest. What is their mechanisms that they can use? And this is one that they are very supportive of. And remember that it includes a much higher local return, meaning a lot of more of the money would go back to the cities for transportation, for streets, et cetera, than the current measure are. So very high support for that. If it does go to the ballot, you certainly will get a lot of presentation, okay? One of the major things that we have talked about is how to invest and what should we be invested in. Chris and Jordan talked about it. We have to invest in our public infrastructure and in education. And so next we're going to have is a panel discussion with three education leaders. And while we set that up, we invite you to take just a 5-minute break.